the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. Please take a seat. It's tough. It's tough, you know. There's so much good material here. I could preach on the gospel. I could preach on the letter to the Thessalonians. Or I could do both. So I thought today I would basically two mini sermons, if you will, my reflections on both of these readings. I'm going to start with the gospel, and I'm going to ignore the first two servants, and I want to focus on that last one for now, because I think there's something really important in that last servant. Remember, he's the one who gets one bag of gold, he goes and buries it. And then a time later, the master returns and he gives him back one bag of gold. And he says, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. It's a really important phrase in there. And it's the problem with that is that would be really easy for us to then take that phrase and apply it to God and say, see, this is the servant's understanding of God. I suspect, you've heard of Carl Jung, the Jungian psychologist, the one who founded that, I suppose, and he talks about dreams. And in a dream, you are every character, or every character in the dream is an echo of something who is in you. I think in the parables, we get something similar at times. Because I don't think the servant here is describing God per se. The servant is describing their picture of God. Now that's, in a sense, an obvious thing to do. We can only ever give our own picture of God. But this person's picture of God is driven by a notion that God is hard and cold and angry and unforgiving. And I suspect that reflects more the servant than it does God. And so the servant judges God, and by the same criteria is the servant judged. On the other hand, the first two servants, they receive something from God and they put it to work, and we don't know their motive, but it might just be that they are good servants of a good, kind, and loving master, and the master reacts in a good, kind, and loving way. It's the same master. It's a different picture, and the different picture leads to a different response. We are judged by the same criteria with which we judge others. And if that's not scary, that's really good, because it means you're not particularly inclined to judge others. If, on the other hand, it's scary, you might have some work to do. Let's look at Thessalonians. Paul is writing to the people of Thessalonica. And he's using light and dark as a bit of a metaphor. He doesn't actually have a problem with nighttime, but rather he's using it as a metaphor, and it makes a certain amount of sense. As he says, most people who do things that perhaps they wouldn't want publicly known do them at night. Most people who are going to break in and steal stuff try and do so, say, at night, because there's less people around to watch. People that are going to go off and get roaring drunk don't do so at 10 o'clock in the morning, normally. It's a really insightful piece of laughter, isn't it? It's like, yeah, well, we shouldn't, but... And Paul doesn't have a problem with a nice glass of red over dinner with friends or something like that. he's talking about behaving in a way that is not good. And so he sets up in his metaphor a light and dark. And then he says, even at night, you can live like you're living during the day. You can live like a person who's visible all the time. In fact, not only can you, but you should. You should constantly be living that way. So the first thing is, live in the light even when it's dark. First takeaway from Paul. Second thing is, be so filled with the light. Be so filled with the light that even in the darkness, the light shines out of you, so that you are light in the dark. Because your life reflects the light of God. So live in the dark as though it is light. Be so filled with the light that you are light. And the last point that Paul makes, and I this is really important. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation. Very different from the gospel reading. From the last servant in the gospel. He died for us. So that whether we are awake or asleep, whether we are still alive, Paul is expecting Christ to return fairly shortly at this stage. But whether we've done well or not, whether we've managed to get it right all the time or not, Christ died for us so that in the end we return to God with Christ. We are bound inextricably to Christ so that in the end we return home to God. So there's the challenges. And a lot of challenges in today's reading. One, be careful of our picture of God, because as we judge God, we are judged. We judge others, we are judged. Live as if you live in the light, so much so that the light will shine through you. Knowing that if things don't go right, if things don't go perfectly, and when, if you slip, we are still bound inextricably to God and make our way back to God in the end. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.